Blackstone Audio presents Jump Cut, a novel by R.R. Irvine. This book is read by Richard Waterhouse. 1. I'd seen enough men die in Vietnam to know that the twitches coming from the pile of flesh and bone in front of me had no real meaning. Even so, I rushed forward to help. As I did, Kurt Gordon swung around, nearly catching me in the head with the edge of his long zoom lens. He took his eye from the camera, scanned the crowd quickly, then looked up at the surrounding buildings to see where the shot had come from. Around us there was a momentary lull, and then the demonstration turned into a full-fledged riot. Police moved in. Feeling like an obvious target, I crouched beside Denny's body. The bullet had gone in through the back and exploded out the front, its impact hurling him against the side of a worn-out Chevrolet. Pieces of flesh spotted the car's rusty door. "There's nothing we can do for him now." I looked at Kurt, who was now squatting next to me, using the Chevy as a shield. "We'll let the cops take it from here. Right now, let's start filming this riot." Kurt unplugged the sound umbilical that tied him to Denny, and then began to film the action. Rocks and bottles showered around us. Guilt mixed with nausea in my stomach. I forced my eyes away from the body. My job was to cover the news, no matter what. While Kurt zoomed and panned with the big Oricon camera, I tried to think about my report for the 6 o'clock news. But memory and morbid fascination got the better of me. My gaze came back to the crumpled body. Blood had begun to leak from beneath it. My stomach felt as if it were leaking too. I shook my head to clear my conscience. My eyes went back to the riot. Whittier Boulevard looked like a battlefield. Police lines surged against the crowd. Officers punched and jabbed with their batons, keeping the blows low and fast so our camera couldn't pick up the infighting. But the confrontation soon got out of hand. We rolled off film of violent overhead blows and bloody heads. The Chicanos fought back with rocks, bottles, clenched fists, and chants of "Viva la Raza! La Raza! La Raza!" "Put on the sound gear," Kurt yelled. "Jesus Christ! We've got to have sound of this." I felt as if I were desecrating his memory, but after an awkward struggle, I untangled the equipment from Denny's body. His eyes stared at me accusingly. His bedraggled mustache looked limp and sad. Kurt reeled me in by the umbilical and screamed in my ear, "Be careful how you point that thing." He indicated the shotgun microphone. "That's the trouble with the damned things. In a riot, somebody could mistake them for a lethal weapon." Gingerly, very gingerly, I pointed it in the direction of the nearest violence. A phalanx of police, awesome in riot helmets and gas masks, moved in, pinning a group of young Chicanos against the side of a building 20 yards away. On a window behind them, I caught faded lettering, "Imperial Hotel," just before the demonstrators were crushed through the massive plate glass. Kurt, unruffled, moved in for a close-up. I threw up a hand to shield my face as he pulled me along. Denny had always said Kurt went crazy during a news story. Now I knew how he felt. Only an hour ago, we had been at the station, crowding our deadline because Denny claimed he was sick and wanted a replacement. "It's too damn late to get anybody else," Kurt had snapped as he hustled Denny into the news wagon. "There's going to be trouble, I know it," Denny whined when we hit the freeway. "The weather. Look at the weather." He was a 50-year-old man on the verge of tears. Denny unbuckled his seatbelt and perched on the edge of the back seat to get closer to Kurt and me in the front. He had a point. The smog was gone, blown out by Santa Ana.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.